So honored to have you. Amen. So glad to be here. Well, you know, it's December, and that means that Christmas is around the corner. Amen. And few weeks away. But here's the thing. That means that we have an opportunity to celebrate the true meaning of Christmas. Amen. And that is the birth of Jesus Christ, that he came. And it's also the anticipation that he's coming again. Can I get an amen in the house this morning? Come on. That's why we celebrate Christmas, by the way. So honored to do that with you this morning. The title of my message is going to be called, Who is the King? I'm excited about this message today. I'm going to put our series verse up on the screen behind me. It says this. It says Psalms chapter 24, verses 8. And it asks that question and gives us the answer. Who is this King of glory? Come on, say it with me. This King of glory is who? It is the Lord, strong and mighty. Say it again. It is the Lord, invincible in battle. Well, we've had a tradition here at NLC since the very conception of our church to embrace an age-old tradition called Advent. And we celebrate it every single year. Some of you might be wondering, why are all these candles here? And I'm going to give the opportunity just to kind of explain that this morning. But here's the reality. Most Christians can agree that Christmas is all about Jesus. But here's the hard truth. Yet, a lot of Christians, right, they don't find it in their calendars to reflect that as a priority, right? And we want to change that. We want God's people to know and understand what it means. And here's the thing. I love presents. You love presents. We love good cooking. We love desserts. We love Christmas lights. We love bonfires, right? We love awesome sporting events and all these special times that we get to spend with all of our family and friends. But here is the honest truth this morning. Without Jesus, though, we have nothing. Come on, somebody. Without him, it's just celebration. But with him, we can celebrate the true meaning of Christmas this morning and this month. And I'm so excited about it. Advent gives us an opportunity to refocus our busy lives and our schedules for the next 4 weeks leading up to Christmas. And this is what it does for us. It's going to give us this opportunity to prepare our hearts in celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen this morning? Come on, that's important. How many of you know that Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords? Did you know that this morning? Come on. He is El Shaddai. He is Jehovah Rapha. He is the beginning and the end. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Can we give him praise one more time in this house this morning? Come on. My prayer this morning is that throughout this Christmas season and the next few weeks, for those that may feel that they have lost their joy, that they find it again. And they find it again in a very real and dynamic way through the power of Jesus Christ. And here's the reality. If you're here this morning or you're watching online this morning, you say, Pastor, I've never experienced true biblical joy, then you are in the right place today. Amen. You're in the right place because we're going to go through God's word and find out what that is. I pray that joy overwhelms you this year. I pray that the true biblical joy that we're going to read about today is just comes all over your family in overflow. Amen. And if you don't have it today, I believe that God's going to give it to you. This morning, we'll be lighting the first of 5 candles that you see in front of me this morning. Advent is a simple acknowledgement of the season of celebrating the birth of Jesus and waiting for his return. This wreath in front of me does this. It celebrates what Jesus truly is, that he is the light of the world, hope, peace, joy, and love. And the center candle that they are this morning represents Jesus himself. John 3:16 says this. We sang about it today. For God so loved the world, come on, say it with me if you know it, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Let me tell you a little bit about Advent in case this is your first time experiencing this. During the biblical times from the end of the Old Testament to Matthew in the New Testament, there were 400 years where God went silent before the coming of his Messiah. Amen. This is Advent. Advent is a time to slow down. It's a time that we pause. It's a time that we prepare our hearts to celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the return of Jesus. I don't know about you, but who is excited about Jesus coming back in this house this morning? Come on. Amen. Are you excited? During Advent, the Christian church today mirrors and symbolizes ancient times when Israel waited in anticipation, like I just talked about, for 400 years for the Messiah to come. Advent comes from the Latin word Adventus, which means coming. It is a season to prepare your heart spiritually to celebrate him. We are mindful of two things this Advent season. Here it is. First, we honor and celebrate the birth of Jesus over 2,000 years ago. And second, we wait in anticipation and look forward to the second coming of Jesus. Today, we're going to honor him today by lighting the candle of joy. I have some special guests. This is my family this morning. And Jaina is going to read to you to scripture, and then she's going to light the candle, and then she's going to lead our congregation in a word of prayer.
Isaiah 9, 6 through 7, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Luke 2:10 says, and the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people.
Amen. Let's everyone bow your heads as Jaina leads us in a word of prayer.
Dear God, we thank you so much, Lord, for this season, Father, just to remember the hope that Jesus brought into our world, Lord, and into our lives. And God, I just pray and thank you this morning for your joy and your peace. And I just pray that as we have this message today, God, that your hope and your joy would just fill our hearts and our minds. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. At this time, our children can be dismissed. In the morning. Amen. Come on, does somebody have joy in the house this morning? Who has joy? Can I see your hand? Come on, can we give him praise? Every week for the next 4 weeks, you know, leading up to Christmas Day, we're going to be lighting a candle, as Jaina was saying, and today's the first one is joy. But I'm going to challenge you in every single message for the next 4 weeks at the very beginning. I want to challenge you about each one of these, right? Because I think what you'll find is when talking about joy, people may say they have joy, but do they have the joy that I'm going to preach about this morning from the Word of God? So I want to challenge you, because the joy that I'm talking about is true joy, right? There's a lot of things that this world can bring to us that give us joy, but true joy only comes from Jesus, amen? It is the only thing and the only place that we can get it from. It is the only one place that can shift your circumstance in an instant. It is the only place that can bring overflow to your heart and to your spirit this morning. It is the only place where the Lord can bring life into a situation where there is darkness. That is the joy that I'm talking about. Can we give him praise one more time? Come on. The joy of Jesus this morning. And here's the scripture that I want to challenge you with. I asked you to raise your hand a few moments ago about praying for you in peace. And here's the deal. If you're going through some hard times, I want this verse to be a reminder in this Christmas season. It comes out of Psalm chapter 31 and 5. David wrote this. He says, I will exalt you, Lord, for you have rescued me. You refuse to let my enemies triumph me. O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you restored my health. You brought me up from the grave, O God. You kept me from falling into the pit of death. Sing to the Lord, all you godly ones, and praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment. Come on, listen to this. But his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may last through the night. But come on, church, say this next part. But what? But joy comes in the morning. If you came in here today and you are trying to find your joy, then you have come to the right place. Amen. Because I believe the power of the Holy Spirit is going to speak this into your heart this morning. So the first thing that I want to do when talking about joy, I want to tell you about an enemy that is trying to come after your joy, that is going to steal it. And the reality is, if you don't make yourself aware of these three things that we're going to discuss this morning and be aware of them in your life, then you open up the door of opportunity for the enemy to come in, because what you're going to see is that he's going to try to do that every single day. So we need to be prepared to defend the enemy against any of these areas. So I want to focus on three specifically this morning under the direction of the Holy Spirit. I believe that these three things God put in my spirit just for you here today. And these are three ways that the enemy wants to steal your joy, and then we're going to talk about them. Number one, by distracting you. He wants to try to steal your joy by distracting you. Number two, he wants to try to steal your joy by discouraging you. Number three, this is a big one. He wants to try to steal your joy by bringing division, listen, between your family, in your marriages, your church, and your friendships. These are the ways that the enemy will be on attack in your life on a daily basis. And if we read over these again, distractions, discouragement, and division, a lot of these things that we just spoke of, these are things that happen, and sometimes we don't even realize that they're going on until it's too late, right? Because it's real easy to get distracted, isn't it? Especially in the Christmas season, right? You know, we get into this moment and this, hey, I've got Christmas shopping to do. I've got this program to go to. I've got to do all these things. And when we get too busy for Jesus, come on, that's when the enemy tries to come in and pounce on us. So I want to tell you this morning, who is this enemy? Well, the enemy is the devil, right? The enemy, the Bible says his name's Lucifer. But I want to tell you who the enemy is, because I can tell you all about distraction. I can tell you all about discouragement. I can even tell you about division. But if you don't even know anything about the enemy and what he's going to try to do to you, right, on a consistent basis, my prayer is that this will open your eyes to make you more alert and sound to the things of God. Peter gives us a warning about who this enemy is, and then Jesus gives us an inside look to the enemy's purpose in all three of these things. So let's read 1 Peter 5:8. Let's read these first two words together. Say it out loud. Come on. Stay alert. Stay alert. Let's stop right there. You need to be alert of all these things that we just went through, right? Discouragement, division, distractions. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. That means that we should be constantly, everybody say constantly, come on. We should be constantly making sure that we are aware of how the enemy can attack us. Because the very moment that you think that he's not going to is when he's going to try to attack, when you're not ready, right? And so you have to be constantly aware of your situation. So who is this enemy? Jesus gives us his purpose in John 10:10. The thief, he's talking about the devil's purpose, is this: to steal, to kill, and destroy you. So I want to break down all of these this morning for you, because this is important to understand. Maybe you came in the house today and you say, well, I've experienced joy, but right now, this moment, on this Sunday morning, I don't feel it. I don't feel the joy that I need to have. Have you ever been around somebody, by the way, that you've come in contact with and you're like, man, they've got something different. Come on, let me see your hand. They've got something in their life that I want. Have you ever felt that way? You know? And I can only think to this lady. Her name was Diane, that was at our church in South Georgia for 5 years. And Jana knows who I'm talking about. Diane is just one of these type of people that is just super bubbly 24 hours a day, right? There is nothing that I have ever seen that shakes Diane. I mean, if we had an earthquake right now, she would raise her hands and pray God, and she sees the good side of why we just had one. Come on, somebody. Do you know that person? I knew Diane, and that's the way she was. What an influence, though, people have like that. And you know what it is? It's because they have the joy of the Lord. They have the true joy. Right? They have true joy. So let's talk about distraction. I'm going to put this up on the screen. You say, well, what is distraction? When the enemy comes after you in this method and form, distractions are designed to keep you off course from God's will. They're designed. Like you, when you wake up in the morning, the enemy has already devised a plan and how he's going to try to distract you. Have you ever thought about that? That's what I'm here for. That's what the Holy Spirit wants to remind us of. When you get up in the morning, when you go home today in your car, the enemy has already devised a plan against you, right? So if we know this, we know that he's coming against us. We know his purpose, right? Peter is telling us in blinking lights, stay alert, church. Stay alert, people of God. You have an enemy that's coming after you. If we can realize this and grasp this, then there's no way the enemy's ever going to steal your joy. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You will find a way to find joy. Any distraction method that the enemy can use against you, he's going to do it. Things that aren't even on your radar. Things that are on the surface may seem innocent to you are designed, listen to this, they're designed to keep God in the distance and distractions in the spotlight. He wants to bring the distractions in the spotlight and take you away from God as far as he can. Distractions come in all shapes and sizes, but if you would only take a moment this morning to examine your personal life, think about it. I want you to think right now really hard. Is there anything in your life this Christmas season? I know it's just the beginning of December, and it's not just for Christmas, by the way. It's through January all the way through, right? Is there anything in your life this morning that's distracting you and keeping you from God? I want you to think about it. Is there anything that you would say, yes, I've put too much concentration in this area, and I see it affecting my life? If you can answer yes to that this morning, that's where your joy, right? That's why you're allowing that joy to be taken, because you're putting something else in its place. And here's the thing, you innocently might not even know you're doing it. That's why I want to bring it to your mind this morning, to be aware. So let's talk about the second thing, discouragement. Discouragement is by definition a deficit of courage. Let me say it like this. Biblical courage is the ability to face uncertainty, adversity, danger, or suffering with faith-fueled hope that God will keep his word no matter what comes our way. That's what biblical courage is. Now I want you to think about what I just said. You know, talking about distractions. Many of you in here today or watching online may have a situation that has come up in your life recently, and you're just like, man, what, you know, this is overwhelming me. This is overwhelming. I am trying to figure out. You have got to have biblical courage. You've got to have biblical courage to know that God will get you through in uncertain situations. And I love James, because James, God gives us James so that we can read to figure this out and how we can apply it in our life, right? So if you're here today and you're like, Pastor, I've been super discouraged by a situation in my life, James gives us a passage, okay? And so no matter what it is, if it's something where you need a healing in your body, if it's something where you need something mentally to be shaped in your mind that you are struggling with right now, if it is a relationship that has gone south on you, if it is just a job situation, no matter what it is, you know, no matter how hard it may feel, the weight on your shoulders this morning, listen to what James says. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, I want the people of God to listen to this, consider it an opportunity for great joy. Great joy. When is the last time that you've been in that moment, right? When it all seems to be on your shoulders, you're like, right now, I have an opportunity to smile. I have an opportunity to give God praise and joy in this moment, in this season. Come on, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, because here's the reality is, it's tough to do that, isn't it? It's tough to do that. And what happens is, that's when the enemy wants to try to come in, and because that's just your most vulnerable state, right? You're at the most vulnerable when things are going on. So let me go back to Diane for a moment. I've seen her and her husband walk some difficult moments, right? But you always saw that joy flow no matter what it was, right? And so there is that moment where we can have that. Let's finish it. And this is tough for us to understand. For you know that when your faith, everybody say faith, is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. When your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. And then he says this, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God, and he'll give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking. Some of you don't have the answer to the very prayer that you need because you haven't asked God yet, right? You haven't asked him yet. You're like, well, why is it this happened? Have you asked him? Have you asked him very specifically? Because he's not going to rebuke you for asking. He wants you to ask. But then it says this, but when you ask him, listen, this is important, be sure that your faith is in God alone. What does that mean? That means that whatever your situation is and how difficult it may be, you don't need to be trying to figure it out on your own. You need to let God figure that out, because we have to put our faith in him. Come on, if you believe that, say amen this morning. Come on. You have to trust him in the moment. That's what James is trying to say. Listen to this, verse 7. Such people should not expect to receive anything from the Lord if they cause to be divided and they don't waver, right? But it says this in verse 8, their loyalty is divided between God and the world, and they are unstable in everything they do, because there are a lot of people that don't put faith in God in their situation. They put faith in everything else, right? And God wants to tell you this morning that you have to have faith in Him. The scripture tells me that, yes, there will be times when the enemy tries to use discouragement to bring you down. But I want everybody in the house this morning to be encouraged. Matter of fact, I want you to turn to your neighbor this morning, if you can get to him, and say, I want to encourage you. Tell him something. I'm going to let you tell him. Tell him something today that will be an encouragement in their life. Come on, do it right now. Encourage your brother and sister in the Lord. This is your opportunity. Come on, tell him. I like it. Everybody's doing it. Come on, I like it. Come on, encourage your brother. This is what I'm talking about. It's an opportunity for great joy when you feel discouraged. Here's the last one. Division. If the enemy can cause division in your relationships, then he can steal your joy. The devil loves chaos. He loves it. It's what he lives for. The devil loves to try to wreck every relationship that we have in life. And I want you to pay close attention to this, because I don't really think that we think about this when we talk about division. Matter of fact, unless you know in math class, you don't talk about division much, right? My daughter does. She's kind of going through that right now in her classes, but both of my kids. But we don't talk about, you know, the only times that we talk about division, meaning division in relationships, it's in church, isn't it? That's when we kind of talk about division. So I want to tell you about division this morning and let you look into why the devil operates this way, right? Because from the very beginning of time till current, he operates in trying to divide people. Ever since, listen, his fall from heaven, when he was kicked out of heaven, ever since then, Satan took angels with him. He tried to cause division from the very beginning. Everybody with me this morning? Come on. He's tried to cause division in this world from the very beginning. Then what did he do after that? Adam and Eve, right? He tried to cause division with Adam and Eve and God. Did he not? Did he not try to tell them, oh, he means something differently. You can eat of the fruit. He's just kidding. He's just kidding. He, if you'll actually take of the fruit, you can be like him. Go ahead, right? He wanted to cause division. That's what he's after. Have you ever known this? Let me say it like this. Division is the devil's playground. It's the devil's playground. It shouldn't be surprising to Christians that he operates this way. Because if you read from Genesis all the way to Revelation, I read of an enemy that is constantly trying to divide every single thing that he does. A lot of people don't know this. Listen to this. The word devil comes from the Greek word diabolos. Okay? It comes from the Greek word diabolos. And this is what it means. Did you know this? This is what the word devil means, to divide, to separate, and more literally, to throw against. Did you know that? Now that you know, we've talked about the purpose that he's coming against you. Did you know that he's constantly trying to divide? Doesn't it make more sense now? You know, how easy it is to get in a spat with somebody, right? Or how easy, I think of it like this right now. Think about our world right now. Think about it. It doesn't matter, you know, what social group is fighting against the other one, but let me tell you and be very specific, okay? When fighting goes amongst other, it doesn't matter who we're talking about, what church, what social, it doesn't matter. What is behind that is the division that the enemy is trying to bring on our world, right? That's what he's done from the beginning, and that's what he will do until Jesus comes back. So Peter wants to tell you this morning to stay alert. Understand that he is going to try to divide you in every single possible thing. Let me say it like this. Where there is division, joy isn't present. Think about it. Just think about everything right now on our planet, right? Where there is division, joy is just not around in it. Because how can Jesus operate when there's division, right? That's what the enemy operates in, division, right? His name means to divide. So we need to be aware of that. Let me tell you this. I'm going to ask Jana to come up at this time, and we're going to go through these. And as we close out today, I want to go through the Word of God with you and talk to you about where joy is found. Because now that you know that you have an enemy that is constantly trying to attack you, come after you in all these ways, right, you need to understand where this joy comes from. Because here's the reality. No matter if it's division, no matter if it's discouragement, no matter if it's distractions in your life that you find yourself in this moment right now, I want you to pray this morning before you leave this place. Come on. I want you to seek God and say, God, is there any of these areas in my life where I have been distracted? Are you discouraged this morning? What caused that discouragement, right? Have you taken that moment to ask God how you can get through that? Or are you just discouraged, right? Are any of your relationships this morning, think about this, your marriages, what's your marriage look like this morning for those that are married in the house? Is there division in it, right? Well, think about your friendships. Think about your relationships if you have kids. What are your relationships look like in your life? Because if there's division in it, come on, somebody, are you understanding me this morning? Say amen. If there's division in it, joy is going to be absent in that situation. Pastor, I don't have joy. Then I would ask you in all of these areas, what does it look like for you this morning? What does it look like? I want to close out today with this scripture. Where is joy found? Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame as he sat down at the right hand in the throne of God. I want to say this to you this morning. Joy can be only found in Jesus. You can search for it any other place, you guys. We can try to find, you know, listen, you know how much I love sports, but sports is always going to let you down. Come on. I'm just going to be honest with you, right? I'm preaching to the choir this morning. My team got shellacked last night on national television. All right? We got shellacked. There wasn't joy in the Williams household with my team getting beat. Come on. Right? What I'm trying to tell you is you're never going to find that true joy in other things. You can only find it through Jesus. Are you hearing me, church, this morning? Come on. You got to find it in the Lord. So what does that look like for me? What does that look like? The word joy has almost disappeared from our current vocabulary in our culture, hasn't it? Think about it for a moment. How often do you come across somebody? How often do you hear somebody on TV? How often do you hear somebody say, I've got the joy? You remember that song? I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Come on, sing it. Down in my heart. Down in my heart, I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart to stay. And then he goes, I've got the peace. You know the song, right? How many of you know joy? How many people you know that have true joy? Man, this Christmas season, I want you to find it. Listen, we're going to have a blast. We're going to do some awesome things here at the church. I know everybody in this room has got things planned that are just amazing for Christmas. And all those things are awesome. I want you to do all those things. We're going to do those things. But Jesus has got to be first. Everybody with me? Jesus has got to be first. Because none of the rest of it, it's not going to matter at the end of the day unless Jesus is first. How often do you hear someone say that? I want you to think about it. One reason is because we have confused joy with happiness. And have come to believe that joy is found in pleasure, security, prosperity. That's where most people think joy is found. In doing this, however, we have believed a lie that comes from the enemy that I've been preaching about this morning. Joy, listen, is not the same as happiness. Although they might overlap sometimes, happiness depends on circumstances. Come on, somebody, but joy depends on God. Let me say that again. Happiness depends on circumstances, but joy depends on God. It depends on our Savior. Happiness vanishes when life all of a sudden turns painful. Joy keeps on going and going and going. Joy can even grow in the midst of, listen, sickness, pain, and various problems and situations that you may be encountering this morning. You can find joy. You may say, well, I don't see it right now. You need to look harder because it's there. Jesus never leaves us. He never forsakes us. He's always there with us. Joy is found in Jesus. You say, well, where do you truly find it? I want to tell you about two places. Number one, it's found in God's presence. David used to sing about it. David used to talk about it. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, you will make known to me the path of life because in your presence is fullness of joy. If you haven't had joy, when is the last time that you were in God's presence? When is the last time that you were in his presence? You say, well, talk to me about his presence. What exactly does that mean? In worship that we did this morning, you can find God's presence. You can find God's presence at worship on your own time. You can find God's presence in devotion. You can find God's presence through meditation that you spend with Him. You can find joy in prayer. You can find His presence in your life group. Come on, you can find His presence at work. Come on, Monday morning, everybody's favorite day. Guess what? You can find joy at work tomorrow in God's presence. Can I hear an amen in the house? Come on, somebody. You can find joy anywhere and anytime. You just got to be open and to find it and make sure that you're serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on, church. Do you want joy this Christmas season? Do you want to find joy and what it looks like in your life? You can find it. But here's the deal. You're going to proactively have to seek after Him, right? Are you proactively? That means, are you giving it everything in your life? Are you making time for His presence? Are you having devotion with Him? Are you coming to a life group? Are you worshiping when you have the opportunity to? Or has distraction set in? Or are you discouraged about something so that's hurt your time and your presence? Everybody with me this morning? Come on. What about division? Man, listen, relationships are tough, and that's the next one. Where do you find joy from? Your relationship with Jesus. That's where you find it. You say, here, listen to this, Proverbs 10:28. The hope of the righteous brings joy. Knowing that we have Jesus living in our hearts, that is that relationship. That is when you become saved, right? You should know immediately, right, what joy feels like, what it is. That's where we find that through salvation. 1 Peter 1:8 says this, you love Him even though you've never seen Him. Though you do not see Him now, you trust Him. And you rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. I want to preach really hard here right now to somebody. Maybe you're watching online. Come on. You say, Pastor, I don't feel joy right now because of my situation. I want to read this scripture to you directly, and I want you to listen to me very carefully. You love Him even though you have never seen Him. Maybe in your situation, you haven't seen God stand right in front of you, and you can see His eyes right in front of your eyes, but He's there. He's there right in front of you. Let me read the rest of it. Though you can't see Him, you have got to trust Him and rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. If you can't rejoice and have joy in the bad times, then how are you going to be able to do it in the good times? Come on, somebody. You're going to have to rejoice in Jesus no matter where you find yourself this morning. Now, James. Man, I love James. Listen to this. James always has something awesome to say about stuff, doesn't he? Listen to this. James 1:2-3. Love this. Count it all joy. Everybody say it with me this morning. Come on. Count it all joy. Let's say it one more time. Count it all joy. If you count it all joy, no matter what you're going through, then your perspective changes, doesn't it? Count it all joy. Man, this may look rough on the outside, but I've got Jesus. I've got the joy, joy, joy coming down in my heart. Come on. It enables you to have that song. You know, that new song. The Bible always talks about singing a new song. So I want to ask you this morning, how many of you have gotten to a place in your walk with Christ that when you have a really bad day or you receive really bad news, your response, listen to this, turns into the authentic joy of the Lord? Instead of getting upset next time, you begin to laugh. Instead of getting worried, you begin to praise. Come on, somebody. Instead of counting it all bad, you've learned to walk in Scripture and count it all joy. No matter what you face in this life, no matter what adversity comes your way, no matter how bad things look or get, no matter if it's out of your control, come on, New Life Chapel, the Word of God declares that we are to face and look at all things through the lens of Jesus Christ and count it all joy. Can I get an amen this morning? Come on. Now let's talk about real things. Let's talk about things you're dealing with today. Let's talk about things as you're watching this service online this morning. Maybe nobody in this place knows what you're going through, but I know somebody that does. You say, well, Pastor, you don't understand my situation. You know what? I probably don't. And that's okay, right? It's okay that we don't understand, but I know somebody that does. You know, I know, but Pastor, remember we sang a couple weeks ago, His strength is perfect. You know, we talked, His strength is perfect when ours is gone. Remember I preached on that side service about this? You say, well, Pastor, I feel weak this morning. I don't even know. I don't know how I'm going to make it through. I don't know what to do. Well, I want to read a scripture to you this morning. It comes out of Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 10. It says, "For the joy of the Lord is your strength." The joy of the Lord is your strength. That's where you find your strength, in the joy. You say, "Well, I'm weak this morning." Well, find some joy in the strength of your Savior today. Find some joy. It's right here. He's telling us what we exactly need to do. And here's the next part that I think a lot of people leave out. Psalms 44. "Oh, the joys of those who trust the Lord." Listen, I have walked some crazy things in my life. We have been in a season, man, I'm telling you, you know, ever since we got into ministry, just things I could spend the rest of the day telling you about, some things that will absolutely blow your mind about how we were in a situation, and if God didn't show up, but let me really tell you, he always does. He always does. He might not show up how I wanted him to, right? Looking back, I'm like, I'm glad he didn't show up how I wanted him to. That's what I think you'll find, by the way. We have this idea of how we want God to show up, and we're like, man, he didn't do what I thought he should. Well, that's because he's sitting back and he's like, yeah, if I show up that way, come on, somebody, it's not gonna be God's way, right? It's your way. And so looking back at all those situations, I had to trust God. I had to. There were moments, listen, you're talking, and for those of you that are visiting this morning, I had no idea where we were going to live. Like, the craziest part of our church plant, I don't talk about this enough. We had stayed on at our church for another 6 months, right? After we told our pastor we were leaving to come plant a church. He goes, "Pastor Mike, where are you planting your church at?" I said, "Pastor Bob, I have no idea. I don't know. Where are you going? I don't know." What do you mean you don't know? God told me to take a step out, and he's going to tell us. I'm telling you, you want to talk about a faith walk? Listen, with a wife with three kids, tell her, say, "Babe, I don't know where we're going, but we're going," right? That don't fly too good in most households, right? Let's be transparent this morning, right? But here's the thing. All of us had to come together. Me, Jaina, Ella Grace, Savannah, Grayson, even as they were little, man, we told them, we're going to trust God through this situation because he has a plan. Everybody with me this morning. He always has a plan. He always does. He's got a plan for everybody over here. He's got a plan for all of you. He's got a plan for every single one of you. He's got a plan. Come on. You feeling me this way? He's got a plan for your life. He does. But you are going to have to trust him. So if you're here today and you're like, "Man, you don't understand. I don't have to." God does. But you're going to have to trust him. That's the piece of this that every Christian in the world struggles with in their life, trusting. Because when situations look so bleak, we're like, "Man, here's what we got to do." I had to get there. Listen, it'll drive you bananas if you try to figure it out. And if you try to force play a door that's closed, that's never going to turn out good for you. Everybody with me on that? If you try to force play something in your life, you're like, "Well, since he's not moving, I'm going to kick it down." Yeah, try that and tell me how that works out. I've done that too, right? You know, you kicked the door down you shouldn't have. Well, that always comes back around, and God said, "Well, you got off path there for a little bit. Let me get you back where you need to be." That is because he's not going to make you. He wants you to trust him. If you're with me, come on, say amen this morning. Come on. I want everybody at New Life Chapel watching this morning to find joy this season. That's what this is all about. Love, peace, joy. All of these things surround Jesus in our relationship. But you've got to trust him. So before we pray, I want to pray this prayer of blessing over you today. It comes out of Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 and 6. And this is the message. Man, this is so awesome. Always be full of joy in the Lord. Always. Always be full of joy. I say it again. Rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. This is what we need to, come on, who is this for this morning? Don't worry about anything. I want to look at the lens of the camera today. Don't worry about anything. God has got this, but you got to trust him. Listen to what it says. It said, instead, don't worry, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for what he has already done. Come on, somebody, that, my friends, is how you find true joy. That is how you find it, right? When is the last time you got in your prayer closet and you said, "God, I'm going to trust you right now, even though I can't see it through. I'm going to trust you," right? I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to trust. And God, I'm going to pray and see this thing through. I'm going to do it no matter what. I'm not going to worry, right? And then at the very end of that prayer, you're like, God, I just want to thank you for what you've already done. I wouldn't even be here right now if you hadn't have got me here. Come on, who's with me this morning? We wouldn't even be at NLC this morning. Come on, if you hadn't have made that happen. I won't even be able to get in my car and go home after this. God, if you hadn't have provided for me, come on. Maybe you're here today and you want joy and you say you don't have it. I know who can give it to you this morning. And it's God. He wants to give that to you in this place. It's always available. But you got to seek after him. Come on, with every head bowed and every eye closed. I want to ask you a very important question today, and I want to pray for you. I'm not going to call you up front. I'm not going to embarrass you. This is just your moment with God. This is you and him. Dana's just going to, I want to do this too. I want you to really pray about this right now personally, by the way. Dana's going to sing just a moment. She's going to sing a chorus. And while she sings, I just want you to just take some time right now. I want you to think about this Christmas season. Where does your life find you on this Sunday morning at New Life Chapel? Or do you have distractions that right now that are keeping you from your relationship with God? Because if you don't have joy, something's keeping you away from it. Maybe you're here today and you're discouraged. Maybe you're watching online and you're like, man, I've got so much discouragement today. I want you to try to seek in your mind and your heart right now, where is the cause of that discouragement? Where is it coming from? Maybe there's somebody here today that has a relationship that is divided. Maybe you have allowed it to be, or maybe someone else has. But here's what I know. It works two ways, right? You're going to have to do your part. And that part is giving it to God, right? No matter if it's a marriage, a friendship, or whatever it may be this morning. The enemy is always coming after you. So Jane is going to sing this chorus, and I want everybody just to pray. And then I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to ask you very specifically on these items this morning. Discouragement, division, all of these things. Jane is going to sing.
There will be joy in the morning. There will be joy in the morning. If it's not good, then he's not done. No, he's not done with it yet. There will be joy in the morning.
Well, no matter what you're going through, sing it.
There will be joy in the morning. There will be joy in the morning. If it's not good, then he's not done. No, he's not done with it yet. There will be joy in the morning. If it's not good, then he's not done. No, he's not done with it yet. There will be joy in the morning.
I want to read this scripture to you with every head bowed and every eye closed, and I'm going to pray for you this morning. Psalms chapter 31 and 5. It's the very first thing I read to you this morning. If you're here today at New Life Chapel and you've been struggling in one of these areas, distractions, discouragement, division. I want to read this scripture to you again. Listen, David was in a situation very similar. I will exalt you, Lord, for you rescued me. I need to tell somebody in the house today that you may not know how to get out of your situation, but God wants to tell you he's going to rescue you right now. He wants to rescue you right now. It says, you refuse to let my enemies triumph for me. He is not going to let the situation triumph over you. Come on, I don't know who you are. You need to hear this. Oh, Lord, my God, I have cried to you for help. Some of you in this room have been crying for help. And God wants to tell you this morning that I will restore your health, is what it says. Somebody in the house, come on. I don't know who. Come on, this is specific. Maybe you're here today. Because this is one of the toughest things as Christians and humans. Praying for yourself or walking through a health battle yourself. Praying for your, listen. I understand that. I get it. But it goes back to me about trust. And I don't know who you are this morning, but I want to read this to you again. Come on, if you're here today and you've been sick in body, I don't know who, if you're watching online, you've been sick in body. I cried out for help, and you restored me. You restored my health. That is confirmation. That is by his stripes you are healed. You have got to have the faith and trust in God to do it. Listen, I understand that maybe a doctor told you, I don't know who this is for, maybe a doctor told you there's no way. I am here to tell you today, I know a God that died on a cross for you, and that the blood of his son Jesus, no matter what sickness you have in this house, right now can be poured all over this auditorium, and in the name of Jesus, you'll be healed. If you don't believe that, then you need to read your Bible this morning. Somebody in this house needs the encouragement of strong, bold faith. I want to pray for you right now. You don't even have to raise your hand. I don't want you to. I want you to pray at your seat. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray right now, Lord Jesus, for a miracle in this house. Lord, I pray for the very person that has struggled with sickness in their body. I pray by the power of your Holy Spirit, God, that you would touch that person and that you would give them bold faith to believe in the name of Jesus right now in this moment, that you will be healed and delivered by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on, somebody. Even with your eyes closed, I need you to clap and give him praise. Come on. Come on. We knew better now. Come on. We knew better now. Come on. I say this often, and I want to tell you this again. Can you imagine what it would have been like walking behind Jesus, being one of the disciples, and just watching him work, watching him get to work, watching him praying? Let me tell you something about Jesus, because I want to remind somebody in the house. You say, well, I haven't got a good report about my situation. I get that too. There was a lot of people that Jesus came, by the way, that had a lot of bad reports to give into them, and I never saw one time that he didn't pray for somebody and they got healed in the name of Jesus. Tell me one time, right? When he prayed, when my Jesus, he says that on this earth, on your time on earth, after he sent his help, he says you will do things like me, and even some that he didn't when he was on earth. Think about that for a moment. What does that mean for me? That means that you can operate in the supernatural through the power of the Holy Spirit. And it all comes back, do you truly believe it? Do you truly believe it? Do you truly, I don't know who this is for, do you truly believe and have faith in God that he can show up right now and heal you? Because if you don't believe it, everybody with me, come on, if you don't believe it, then how in the world do you expect something to move in your life? You're going to have to just let that resonate in your spirit, right? You just got to let that resonate in your spirit. Come on, with every eye closed. If you've been distracted, if you've been discouraged, or you've got some relationships that have had division and it's stolen your joy this season, or even today, I want to tell you, God wants to restore you right now. And I want to ask you bold. Nobody's looking. Here's a bold move for you. This is your move. This is what you just prayed about. God, I need you to move in one of those areas. Don't hesitate. Raise your hand. Come on. I need you to move in one of those areas in my life. Come on. There's a hand. There's a hand. Come on. Hand, hand, come on, lift it up. You say, why? This is what I'm just going to be, because I, now that I'm a pastor, I look back at growing up in church, and I'm like, why did pastor always ask us to raise our hand? What does that even mean, right? Because God can move whether you raise your hand or not, right? Let me tell you why that's important, okay? It's important because it makes us go after God. It makes us say before him and him alone, that I believe and I trust you right now in this moment to move. That's what it means. I remember I struggled for so many years worrying about what everybody thought about me at church. I really did. I remember just sitting where my daughter's sitting on the front row and my parents worshiped and led and did all of these things. We'd have an altar call. I had to come to the conclusion that it is a relationship with me and Jesus Christ alone. Nobody else is going to do it for me but him. Come on, somebody. And when I realized that, when I realized that at the age of 14, by the way, when I realized that it doesn't matter what people think, right? It doesn't matter if they go home and talk about me. What it matters to me is that I am going to get things right with Jesus no matter what anybody else says, right? And when I do that, he will honor you. That's why we raise our hands. That's why we raise our hands. That's why we worship. We go after God proactively. Come on, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm going to pray for you. Dear Jesus, God, we thank you today. God, for these hands that were raised in this building. Father, I pray right now, Lord Jesus, for the person, God, that is struggling with distractions in their life. I pray right now for you to remove them. God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray right now, God, if there is someone watching online or someone in the sanctuary today, God, that is discouraged. God, I know what it's like to be discouraged. God, it feels so heavy. It feels so weighted. God, but I pray for that person today that raised their hand, or maybe they didn't. God, that you would deliver them and give them some joy in the name of Jesus. God, there's some folks that came in here today, God, that's been struggling with relationships. And God, after hearing this message and seeing how that the enemy is always trying to divide, because that's what he does, today was their acknowledgement to you today, God, that they want you, number one, in their relationships. God, I pray that you would give those individuals a supernatural empowering of your joy today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, if you'll stand to your feet in this house, can we give God praise? Come on, stand up this morning. Come on. Give me praise. Joy. Come on. Let's sing that chorus one more time. Come on, it's "There Will Be Joy." Come on, sing it with Janice. Sing it.
There will be joy in the morning. There will be joy in the morning.
Love this part, come on.
If it's not good, then he's not done. No, he's not done with it yet. There will be joy in the morning.
There will be
joy in the morning. There will be joy in the morning. If it's not good, then he's not done. No, he's not done with it yet. There will be joy in the morning.
Amen, amen. I want to go around the room one more time before I close this out and pray, and our gentlemen are getting ready to come. But listen, I want to look you straight in the eye this morning and tell you this. If you're going through something, there's joy coming in the morning. Come on, somebody. If you're here today, you have some struggles, there's joy coming in the morning. There is joy coming in the morning. Come on, people of God. There is joy coming in the morning. There is joy coming in the morning. There is nothing that we will face in this Christmas season that God can't bring joy. Come on. He will give you joy. I promise you that. So as we leave today in a few moments, man, walk out of here knowing that you've got a Savior that loves you. You've got a Savior that wants to give you everything, and he wants you to operate in his joy in Jesus' name. Come on, give him praise one more time. You may be seated. Our gentlemen are going to come this morning. I forgot to mention this the past couple of weeks because it's kind of new to me too, but on the back of your seats, there is a scan. You can use your phone and scan to pay. Right now, it'll actually work on this screen. Pretty cool. Keisha back there. Can we give Keisha a hand where she's back there? Yep, come on. Keisha, can you wave at us? Woo! Your Mike Bird's waving. He's pointing at her. Yep. Man, she did this for us, and she does such an awesome job for our team and our staff this morning. But listen, I want to talk to you about this. We have been in prayer. Man, God, listen, I can just, for the past several years, taking a step out in faith. And, you know, when it comes to giving, I think that, come on, man, the Lord's just, whoo. When it comes to giving, okay, it's for some people, they're just like, man, I don't get it. I don't understand it. Do you want blessing in your life? I'm going to ask everybody in this room. Come on. Do you want to be blessed? You want to be blessed? You want to be blessed? How about you guys? Then you honor Jesus, number one, in everything that you do. Period. Right? That's with joy. Relationships with giving. When you honor him first, that's when he's going to bless you. And I can tell you stories all day long when we've had to trust God within this, right? We've got a couple things that we've been praying for. These are some things in our harvest fund. God has really been blessing us these, and we've got one more month. And we're going to believe that every need on this screen behind me will be met, and I believe that. Because last year, we had something just like this, and God came through and took care of every single thing. And I believe he's going to do it again. So as we go to the Lord in prayer today, here's what I want you to do. I want you to ask God specifically, God, how would you have me give today? How would you have me speak into your kingdom today in Jesus' name? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. God, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that right now we have the opportunity, Lord Jesus. God, in your word, Lord Jesus, that says when we give, God, from our heart, we are joyous. God, and it even means hilarious. God, that we can give joyful today in everything we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Joy. I remember, Pastor, the song, I've Got Joy Like a Fountain. At a Christian school where I serve as principal, I got to lead a chapel. I got joy like a fountain. And you guys may remember that song, right? Joy Like a Fountain. And also singing Joy to the World, a song we typically only sing around Christmas time. But what joy. I tried to explain in just words. We can't even fathom the joy that they had to have, that the Messiah has come. And, you know, when I think about joy, I told our kids, remember this acronym for joy. Jesus, he's got to come first for you to have true joy. Others before yourself. That's the joy. Jesus, others, then yourself. So I can't help but share, we were talking about this in Sunday school, from Psalm 51, a famous psalm of David, where David was so broken because he had committed adultery. He had had a man murdered. So when you think about your sin and you think about your weight being too hard to carry, somebody might need to read this confession and prayer that David had when he says in Psalm 51, verse 2, wash away all my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin. And then, guys, I want to focus on verse 8. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Some of you may have felt bones crushing in your spirit. But David says, let me hear joy and gladness. In verse 12, he says, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Raise your hand if you're saved and you remember that joy, that moment. You remember that? You remember that undescribable joy? You still can share that. Let others see the joy of the Lord in you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the assurance of your salvation. When we trust you, when we put our faith in you, we know that your grace, we know that your word says by your stripes we are healed. And that joy can only be found in you, not in this world, not in materialistic possessions, not in celebrities, not in people. Joy can only be found in our Savior. And we thank you, God. I pray a special blessing over every person here. That you bless them, that you watch over them, God. Whatever need they may have, whatever persecution they may be experiencing, whatever situation may arise, may we find joy and hope knowing that you're coming back. In Jesus' name, and everybody, all of God's people said, amen. You are dismissed.